Welcome to Momentum Investing, property investing made easy. One of the world's top podcasts on property investing, bringing you the top experts in the field so you can learn firsthand what it takes to create passive income and take control over your financial future.
Welcome, Momentum Investor, to the Momentum Investing Podcast. We got a special treat for you here today. Our guest is Shimon Rudish, one of the top property solicitors in the entire UK. Over the last decades, Shimon has been working on building his own portfolio as well as starting and running one of the most successful law firms in the UK for property conveyancing. His law firm, MS Law, specializes in lease options. And if you're doing a lease option, they're the top firm out there for making sure it's done legally and smoothly. In addition, Shimon himself is one of the top solicitors when it comes to creative financing and how to structure a deal. So he teaches all over the UK, every single major educational company in the UK, including, of course, Momentum Property Education, has hired Shimon to teach creative financing, lease options, and creative structures. An easy way to explain it is if a company is going to do a course on creative property investing, how to structure deals in the correct way, but also to get the maximum amount out of it, Shimon is the first person you call to make sure he's there. So that's why I'm so excited to have him on this episode, because in this episode, he shares how you can make your deals more successful, how to look at joint ventures, how to look at creative financing, and what's going on going forward. So make sure you stay tuned, because this episode is going to be powerful. It's going to give you a lot of value and help you get as much as possible out of your property investing efforts. All right, welcome to Momentum Investing. We're here with Shimon Rudish. Shimon, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, buddy.
So we're honored to have you here. I mean, you got a wealth of experience and then some. So we're very happy to have you here to share, you know, your knowledge, your background. And we had you recently on one of our mastermind calls, which was great for our kind of inner circle investors to help them with their journey. And a lot of them, they love hearing about joint ventures and kind of how you structure that. So I thought that's how we'll start. And you can share with everyone a bit about, you know, what are the do's and don'ts in a joint venture kind of a partnership?
Oh, hello, everybody. Thank you for the kind words, first of all. Well, I would say that there are a few tests that you have to do. So first of all, you have to start from the beginning. The beginning is why I'm joint venturing. Because until you understand why you're joint venturing, you don't understand why you're checking things up. So why do you joint venture? A lot of people, unfortunately, joint venture either because they feel lonely, you know, much more fun if you have someone that you work with, or in the property circle, it often happens that people that joint venture are joint venture with people that they were sitting next to at the course or mastermind or whatever. Potentially there is some synergy there, but they're missing the reason why they are joint venturing. There is one single important reason why, and it's only one reason why you joint venture with someone, that is money. You joint venture only if by joint venture you make much more money. I often explain it that is a case of bad math, meaning 2 plus 2 makes 5. If 2 plus 2 makes 5, you joint venture. Yeah. Now, before you tell me, Shimon, you don't know how to count, let me explain. If by on my own, I can buy in a year, let's say five single buy-to-let properties, and if I joint venture with John, I can buy 10 buy-to-let properties. It's not worth it, because 100% of 5 and 50% of 10 is the same thing. Yeah. We're assuming that the properties are all the same size, shape, and...
Oh, obviously. If we call them the exact same street, you buy 10 on the same street. Yeah.
Not only is it not worth it, it's actually not even worth it. It's less than worth it, because... when you joint venture, there is always the risk that something goes pear-shaped, something doesn't work out, or that you have arguments or things like that. So there is a risk involved in joint venture. Like everything else, there is a risk. So when is it worth to take the risk? When? If on my own, I can buy 5 single legs, and if I joint venture with John, I buy 15, I buy 20. Or on my own, I can buy 5 single lets. If I joint venture with someone, I can buy 5 commercial properties that convert in 50 flats, which was actually what I was doing before the coronavirus happened. I had 51 flats and 3 shops to be developed in the next 14 months, and now is everything suspended here in England. So
I think that's a great point that you make to everyone, is that it's about finding someone that complements you and helps you grow faster. So it's not about just doing a joint venture to have someone to hug when it goes hard. It's about getting more and growing quicker together.
Absolutely. That now you point out at the next stage, which is, once you understand why you do it, is you are doing 2 tests. They have to pass 2 tests with the person you joint venture. One is an objective test and one is a subjective test. The objective test is, you mentioned complementarity, meaning you want to joint venture with someone that brings assets or skills that you don't have. And you bring assets and skills that he doesn't have.
Right.
So if you joint venture with someone that have the same set of skills, it's useless. It's simply useless. And I would say that in the property world, the two most common correct joint venturing formats are John, for example, is a great marketeer. He can find leads on the internet because he knows algorithms, internet, Google, Facebook, things like that. But he has 0 people skills.
Right.
And you have Mark, on the other hand, which is a great negotiator. He will sell rice to the Chinese. But when it comes to internet, Facebook, algorithms, or a microwave, for him, they're all the same. That makes sense? So one generates a lot of leads, the other with negotiating in deals. Right. Or, for example, you have John, which is a very seasoned and experienced property investor, and is very successful in what he does. But if instead of being able to play with his amount of money they put aside, he finds a joint venture partner that gives him a nice chess war, then he could do much, much more.
Yeah, and that one we see a lot as internationals is, you know, someone here will have money and then they'll joint venture with someone local who has the deals and the expertise.
Which is what happened between you and me. And
exactly.
It's not just because I like you. You brought something that it was useful for me. And and so that is the first step. That is an objective test.
So for you, those of you listening, just as a heads up, me and Shimon do a lot of deals together. So that's why he's mentioning. I sadly have to pay for all the deals, but he has to do all the work. And that's why it works.
So that is the first test. The second test is, and you move on test number 2 only if you fulfill test number 1, is this the kind of person, subjective test, that I can work with? So you have to see someone that has a similar view of life or ethics, anything like that. An example we'll say is if the person that you want to joint venture with, now let's actually, first you see who you are. Knowing who you are, I'll give the example myself. Me, Rudik, I'm a very, I see words in black and white. I don't believe in gray. And not just because I'm a solicitor. That is who I am. Something is either legal or illegal. It's not like more or less. No, it's not more or less. It is illegal or illegal. And I don't cut corners. I'm not telling you wrong. I'm not an angel. Being Italian, and I pass with the traffic light is yellow, or I did park on double yellow lines. I haven't parked in 2 months. I'm stuck at home and I'm not planning to leave my home for the next foreseeable future. I'm already told my kids that they can forget about schools until 2021 in France. And knowing me, I know that I don't work well with people that put money first, second, and third, because these kind of people will justify anything in order to make money. Yeah. So they will cut corners, they will be at best economical with the truth with lenders or other people. I don't do these things. So I know that it wouldn't work well. Or for another example, as Daniel knows very well, I'm very keen that people that send me an invoice, any tradesman or people who works for me, gets paid right away. Yeah. And first of all, you generate a great relation with people that you work with. My tradesmen love to work with me, not just because I'm a nice person, which I like to think that, but also because they know they get paid right away. So if I have an emergency, my tradesmen, if they cannot come right away during the day because they're busy on another project, they will come at night to solve my problems. Mm. But that is not the most important things. Most of these people, they don't have our wealth. They have to rely on what they work on. Yeah. If every invoice that they send out is delayed for 30 days, means that for 1 month, they don't have any money. Mm-hmm. They can't afford that. It's not like me and you that even if I don't work for a month or two, I still have money for the bread on the table. If they don't get paid for a month or two, they starve. Mm-hmm. The children will starve. I don't think it's right. Last but not least, in my religion, I'm an Orthodox Jew, in case you didn't notice my couple and my beard and my sidelocks or whatever. In my religion, it specifically says that someone that you employ on a daily basis, if at the end of the day comes to ask for money, you have to pay him. It doesn't say you pay him next week or next month. You pay him right away. Mm. And so people I know what works for me and which kind of people work with me. So I know that people that are cut corners, ethically not 100% sound, or they are so disorganized that they pay people, or they find excuses not to pay people right away because it's better for the cash flow, won't work with me. Because, for example, another example very good for me, I can't stand people with big egos. People that have, three Ferraris, two gold Rolex, helicopter, and things like that. I don't know. I'm not saying they're bad people. I'm not saying that people that I know that I cannot work well with are bad people. The synergy will not work as well.
Yeah. Well, and the thing is, it's important to remember, and I think this is something that we've learned, is that whenever you start a joint venture with someone, it is honestly like getting married. I mean, you're going into a long-term relationship, and that means even small things can, as anyone who has been in a long-term relationship knows, even small things can become very big over time. And when you're tired and grumpy, small things become big. And it's the exact same thing in a business relationship. It's better to date for a while, get to know each other and just say, look, let's be friends, but let's not get married if you see that there is a value conflict there. So I completely agree, 100%.
Yeah, that's a very important part depends also on the kind of business you are together. When I started my law firm in Miss Law on my own, and then when I didn't have a penny, so I was the solicitor, the secretary, the receptionist, the partner, marketing guy, and when I started to, within a few months, I became very successful, and I couldn't cope with all. So I called a friend of mine, and I says, drop the job where you are and join me. And I give you 50% of the business for free because
a generous offer.
And I couldn't get, I was turning down work.
Right.
And it was that. But while I was still working full time as a solicitor, meant that I was at the very least 9 to 5, in reality, it was often 9 to 9 mm-hmm. in the beginning, in my office with him. So I spent more time with him than with my wife. So that and doesn't matter how great relation you can have with your business partner. So the first thing is that you're going to spend a lot of time with someone. You want to spend time with someone that you go along, otherwise it is not going to work well. No. Secondly, there has to be an understanding and a kind of respect, and I'm not saying love, but respect and liking of the other person, because sometimes there are misunderstandings. Mm. And sometimes you need to, like in a marriage, you say, okay, fine. It's not what I wanted, but it's still fine. Mm. Rather than digging your foot and says, no, I said it's this, it must be this. Yeah? Tuesday night is football. You don't like it, go. No, it doesn't work that way.
Well, I'll remind you of this the next time you get angry with me. I'll remind you of what you just said now.
And well, I didn't marry you yet. And and if anything, in the next episode, well, I prefer Gisella to you.
I get that. She is a lot prettier than I am.
So the is both the objective test and the subjective test are equally both important. Yeah. So, but there's no point you do the subjective test until you did the objective test.
Just to summarize that for everyone. So the objective test, do your skill sets, do what you bring to the table, complement each other. So for me and Shimon as an example, I bring the money, he brings the deals, he does all the work and I pay for it. That's the objective test partnership. The subjective test is, do we like each other and will we be able to survive in a long-term relationship together?
Yeah, perfect. Very good. What if these two things work, then you do your due diligence. It's amazing how many people joint venture without doing the due diligence on the other person. Mm-hmm. Or how many people give money to other people without doing due diligence. Yeah. I'm not saying every day, but once a week maybe. Once every 2 weeks, I hear about people that being scammed.
Mm. Well, hey,
I mean, it's so common.
One of your builders. I mean, this is not a joint venture, but even there are shoddy builders out there that if you don't do your proper due diligence, they will rip you off. You were telling me about one of your projects.
Yeah, and I don't claim to know everything, although I've been 19 years in the property business as a landlord and 19 years in the property business as a solicitor. So I have twice as much more knowledge than most people.
So 38.
Because I see the things from many angles.
Well, that's the power, yeah.
I still learn something new every day. My biggest lesson in 2019 was to change the way I do my project by having a full-time property manager for all my projects. And because I cannot do everything. And besides, my property manager has even more experience than me in development because he has built Tesco, hotels, travel lodge, block of flats, developments. And so
we actually have Michael, who's the project manager, coming on a future episode. So that's going to be really cool. So for everyone who wants to learn about developments, stay tuned and make sure you subscribe because Michael will show you how to do that.
Yeah, and he's a great guy. And by all means, you can approach him and use him as a project manager. And it doesn't have to be a big development. Even you get a big house and you convert it in 8, 7, 9 bedroom HMO. Provided it is economically viable for him to get involved, it's for you, it's certainly worth it. Because the number of people that get builders, the best case scenario is sometimes builders pretend to be more experienced than they are. Mm. And so jobs are not done in the right sequence or not done in the right compliance. Yeah. And they will either cost you more because it's not done properly or takes longer. And worst case scenario, they run out of funds and then they start cutting corners that you don't want or they disappear altogether. Yeah. And
I think anyone who's an experienced investor has had that happen to them. I mean, sadly, it's happened to me more than once, actually. And you learn, it's as T. Harv Eker always says, you know, that they will, you know, if you don't learn a lesson, it's like the universe taps you on the shoulder. If you don't hear it, you know, it whispers you in your ear. If you still don't hear it, you get a slap on the face. And sometimes it's, for some of us, we need to get that punch before we actually learn something.
Well, a clever person learns from his mistake. A better person learns from other people's mistakes. That is the power of
Well, that's courses, the difference between everyone listening to this podcast and you and me, I guess. They're learning from our mistakes. They're not going to do them. We're the ones running around making them, right?
And when I started buying properties, people didn't run courses 19 years ago. So I bought my first property when I was still a trainee solicitor. I knew nothing. And the mistakes, I made mistakes at the beginning that they were quite painful. Mm. Not that he made the, thanks God, every project I have so far has been always very successful. But I made the same first project. It was a single let. I bought it, I refurbished it, I tenanted it. Then I sold a few years later only because I relocated. Mm. At the time I was living in Hull and then we moved back to Manchester. And I made more money from that single sale than any given year as an employee solicitor. It was the first hint that there is much more money in property than being a solicitor. Yeah. But I would have made even more money if I knew how to check, because people did mistakes and I didn't spot them.
Right.
For two reasons. A, I trust the guy, and B, I didn't have the knowledge to check it in any event properly.
Yeah.
And so the mistakes happen. The problem is not making mistakes. We make mistakes all the time. Every person that I work with, I'm expecting making mistakes. What I'm also expecting is that when a person makes mistakes, I will first of all admit it and then fix it.
Yeah.
And but some people can't. For example, I recently changed my architect because they made a mistake. He wasn't humble enough to admit a mistake. And for me, it was like, if you cannot admit a mistake when I know that you did it, how do I know if you make mistakes in the drawings and I didn't spot it, and you will go back and says, oh, I made a mistake, let me fix it. You won't.
No.
Maybe you do, I don't know, but at this stage, I lost my trust. Mm. And once there is no trust between people working together, you cannot work it, because every time you have to second guess it. Did he tell me the truth? Maybe, maybe not. Well, if you trust the person, even if you think, is it really that? I trust the guy, fine, I trust him, I do it. And that is important. So the next stage.
That's a good point you make too, as well. That I just want everyone to really grasp is that importance of humility. Because it's okay to make a mistake. We all make mistakes. Every investor's made more mistakes than we wish to remember. But if you learn from them, if you're humble enough to accept them, then you can move forward and actually succeed in the future.
Yeah, and the truth is. You learn more from mistakes by doing things right. Because if you only do things right, you don't learn something new.
Yeah.
Mistakes are part of what we do. I sometimes I hear people when I do large commercial to residential redevelopments, and this is, oh, why is it taking longer, or why is it taking cost a bit more money? You know, if you buy two bedroom single house or flat, and you need, even if you have to completely refurbish it, how much money, how much can go wrong when you have to repaint, recarpet, and put a new kitchen or a central heating? How much can go wrong, and how much extra unforeseeable problems can there be?
Yeah.
Now, it should cost £10,000, you put 20% for contingency, okay, we cost 12, 13, big deal, £2,000-£3,000 more. When you're doing a redevelopment of the cost you, I don't know, £900,000.
It would take the one we're doing, £1,000,000 right there, yeah.
Just the contingency is £200,000. And that one is still an estimate, because until they don't start moving walls, taking the plaster out, digging, you know the expression, until you don't start digging, you don't know what is done there.
Yeah.
I bought buildings where we had to move, obviously you have to move walls, but only when we started taking the plaster, we realized that wall couldn't be simply removed.
Mm.
And it's not a question, oh, why didn't you know it before? How would I know before? I cannot start making holes in the walls in a product that is not mine before exchange. I cannot tell to a vendor, sorry, can I come there and transform your office or your pub into a Swiss cheese? No.
Well, I have an example there too of a much smaller deal that one of our clients did. Was they started removing the walls, and it turned out that they had been done out of a clay compound with grass, like hay. It was like this really weird wall that someone.
That is a very old, only the internal walls or also the external one?
No, it was all just the inside wall. So it wasn't the external wall, but it.
That must have been a very old building.
It was. I think it was the husband had built it, had done those things himself. So it wasn't a proper builder that had done it. But the problem
the husband. No, yeah. Usually when you find something with mud and grass is 100 years ago. My last home, not the one that I live in now. Hmm. This one here is not my home, by the way. And over 100 years old house, and so plaster is a bit blown up in certain places. Remember the first time when I was there, the first time a kid made a hole in the wall, meaning just put the wallpaper and some plaster came out. I asked someone to come and replaster the place, and I was there, I saw hair sticking out, and I was like, what happened to the building? The Chernobyl that he lost his hair while he's plastering this wall? And so the priest said, no, that is hostel. And I was like, what? What is a hostel doing on the first floor of my house? You know? And he says, no, you understand. 100 years ago, we didn't have the technology to do sheets of wood this wide. Yeah. So they used the plasters, the walls were built in wood, of course, but beams that are this wide, like a couple of inches, and so beam after beam, but between each beam there were gaps. Right. So in order for the plaster to attach to the beams without going through the wall, through the gaps, they mix the plaster with horsehair, because they had a lot of horses here in England. And don't get me wrong, 2,000 years ago, the Romans taught them to build them properly with the bricks and things like that, but they forgot. But for me, it was like horsehair. And so that is something. Down south, especially, you can find buildings built that way. And I remember watching a webinar, and they're beautiful, built with mud. And the risk is actually is, and they should be listed as it happens, is that you don't get a lender to give you full amount of money on a risk like that.
Yeah, exactly, because it's not standard construction, so they'll
give no standard construction. There are various no standard constructions that are applicable historically to different parts of the country, and the one typical no standard construction is something called prefab. Mm. And so there were houses that were built quickly by the government after the war, because after the war they needed a lot of houses, and they were not considered. They were not. I mean, they looked like normal houses from the outside, yeah. But the idea was to build something quickly because people needed places. So they weren't built in bricks in the normal way, and indeed it was considered temporary, and they should last 40, 50 years. Mm-hmm. And although they were built so well that still now they're still standing. But you know, they passed the expiry date. Yeah. So I actually had a very, I remember a few years ago, a chappie came to me, and a typical case of someone that wanted to invest in property, didn't know what he was doing, and he almost lost everything, including the shirt he was wearing. Because he saw a property in an auction that he liked in London. He went all the way there overnight. In the morning, he couldn't buy that one, but he found another couple of properties that were very cheap. So he bid them and he bought them. And one of them was a prefab. So he exchanged when the auction was offer accepted. And he had 4 weeks to complete. Spent 3 weeks getting a mortgage, and he couldn't.
Well, so, and that's an, I just want to freeze there, just an important point for those who haven't bought at auction. What happens is, as they say, once the gavel goes down, that is what you call an exchange of contract, meaning you've all, the moment the gavel goes down, you've signed the contract, you have to buy the property, and you have 4 weeks to do it. So after 3 weeks,
usually 4 weeks, you have to check your auction pack whether it is 4 weeks. Sometimes the solicitor for the vendor puts only 2 weeks. Mm. And it's very, very important that you get a solicitor always to check your auction pack. I have advice as a law firm. We had advice clients sometimes to, it was cheaper for them to lose the deposit than to buy the property.
Yeah.
It was not worth nearly what there were people. There was one guy, not mentioning names, that used to teach, going around the country, teaching property investors to buy properties that have problems and then put them in auction. And hide the problems. No. And it was a great strategy. What do you want? Now people make money. And so if something is missing from the auction pack, it's not because they forgot. It's intentional usually.
Right. And, so, but, so that was his strategy. Buy crappy properties, put them on auction, and try to hide the...
Yeah, he actually used to say, make them look even worse, trash them. And so people think, so it's a gem, but I have seen many times people losing money, serious money. So going back what we're talking about, joint venturing, so the next stage is the due diligence. So, and like in everything else you do in life, you should do due diligence. And you do your due diligence, as you use an example, on someone before you marry her, And now you want to check that she's not an ex-convict, that she's not already married to someone else. And you do due diligence when you joint venture with someone or you give money to someone. There are many things that you can do as a joint venture, as a due diligence. If someone tells you, oh, I'm an experienced property investor, I done loads and loads of projects, fine, show me a project. If he tells you, oh, I don't have any live project now, can I see some X project? If he keeps telling you no when you ask him something, perhaps it's a red flag. If he says you, oh, I have a lot of experience in joint venture with people, fine, can I speak to any your present or former joint venture partner? And if he tells you, oh, they're all out of the country now, again, maybe it's a red flag. And if he says, I'm a very successful property investor, fine, can I see your accounts or credit scoring or something? And I don't need to see all your accounts, but at least show me your credit scoring.
Well, you have to be able to show something. If you can't show a partner, if you can't show a history, if you can't show a deal, well, then...
Yeah, you have to show something. I personally wouldn't share my accounts. But you want to do my credit scoring? I do. Credit scoring shows that you're successful. At least that you're not losing money. Now, if you claim that you're making a lot of money and then your credit scoring comes as minus 13, perhaps you're not as good as you claim to be.
Yeah.
And come to see my project, by all means, and I can show photos, videos, physically come. But I'm so busy that there is always at least an ongoing project with me.
Yeah.
And I even do it with my mentees. I always take them to see my live project, at least one live project, because it's useful. And people learn from these things. You want to see a project? Come. I don't have a problem with that. Check them out. If they said that they've been investing in a certain area for many years, ask around. If you don't live in that area, do it on Facebook. I mean, before doing due diligence on your potential joint venture partner, ask him, do you mind if I ask around about you?
Yeah.
I think it's courteous. If he says, no, I don't want you to ask around about me, then, you know, again, maybe there is a red flag there. There are many Facebook property groups. Most of them are even free.
Yeah.
Just join them. The biggest one is All About Property. And I'm the senior admin, but needs to join it. And then after you ask permission from the joint venture partner, write a post that says, guys, does anyone know Shimon Rudik? Does anyone know Daniel Wood? And if you have some information, please PM me. And someone will tell you. And you check them out. You have to check them. Check they have companies. Check a company house you can check in. England, I don't know how it works in Sweden, but in England, you can check, you put a name and you find out how many company he's director of. And then you check the submitted accounts on each company. If his companies are, we do that also for builders, we were actually discussing before, me and Daniel, on a potential builder. If a company house, this builder that claims to be very experienced and doing huge projects and lots of projects both here and abroad and things like that. And then a company house, it shows that he has a turnover of £4,000. Perhaps.
Yeah.
Unless he's doing them for free.
Exactly.
Perhaps if something is... I'm not saying that he's outright dishonest, the guy. But obviously, there is some discrepancy between what he's saying and what he looks at company house.
Yeah.
And maybe there is a reasonable explanation. Or maybe there is something dodgy, but that is already...
It's a question we have to make. We have to ask the question, why am I not finding what you've told me I should find?
Yeah, exactly. Now, you say you're making a lot of money from properties, a company house, you're the director, only one company, and you actually didn't even submit the accounts last year. And I have dealt with people that wanted to work with me, and I look at company house, there are a few companies, some have little profit, or some, another that two had no accounts submitted for the past 2 years, and the company house is on the way to strike them off. That doesn't give the impression of someone that I want to work with. Now, if you're not using a company anymore, close it by all means.
Yeah.
But you know, if you're...
And I think that's an important point too to make. for internationals versus the UK. In the UK, it's so easy to open a company or close down a company. It's not a failure to close a company. We start SPVs all the time that we open, do a project, and then close down. The difference is there's a difference between getting the company stricken off and closing it voluntarily, or going bankrupt and closing it voluntarily. And it's important to understand that if they haven't been giving accounts and they're about to be stricken off, that's a question you have to ask.
Absolutely. It's actually interesting. Property, like in anything that can generate a lot of money, brings also a lot of naughty people in. Mm. So there is no month that I don't hear about someone very naughty doing something. So a few weeks ago, I was told that someone that I knew, not that I'm friendly with, actually fell out a few months ago. And then I was vindicated that I was right to doubt his words. Apparently, packed up and moved from South Wales to Australia with £700,000 of money that he borrowed from other people. Mm-hmm. Not that brilliant, not the things of kind, but I remember that a chappy, I won't use his real name, his initial R-B-R, and used to be quite known in the property community, and he used to speak on stage, run courses for one of the main property organizations. I started to borrow a lot of money and eventually didn't repay people back, and he was made bankrupt for over 3.7 million pounds.
Wow.
And so people say, oh, what a naughty guy. Yes, you're right, he's a naughty guy. But what about all the people that gave him money without doing any due diligence on the guy? Mm. In England, we have an expression that says, a fool and his money soon part ways. Because, you know, if you're an idiot, you're going to lose your money. Mm. No, I'm not saying that they justifying the dishonest guy. Absolutely, dishonest guy lashes, you know, punch him on the face. But you have to also admit that you're an idiot for giving money to someone. And why do I know that they didn't do any due diligence? Because if you did at least a little bit of your due diligence, a company house, you would have found out that he already had one company going bankrupt. Mm. It was 10 years before, because I know the guy for many years. He's a nice guy. He's the kind of guy you enjoy talking one evening for a couple of hours. He's knowledgeable, he's charming. And obviously, if he wasn't knowledgeable and charming, he wouldn't have been able to take your money, right? So he used to have a managing agency down south. I think it was in Kent, around there somewhere. For me, anything farther down than Birmingham is down south. So Kent and London and all these areas is the same thing. So his company, so he had a managing agent, was managing properties for others. And you understand the expensive properties there, and rent is expensive. So deposit would be at least £1,000. And this was before deposit needed to be protected, and that's the reason why they made it obligatory in this country to make deposit protected, because people started to make them disappear. So what happened? This guy set up and decided, you know what? I make my company bankrupt. We run out of money. Bankrupt. In this country, in England, bankruptcy is a joke. I'm sure that in Sweden, it's like in Italy, that is a serious matter.
Oh, in Sweden, it's serious bankruptcy. Yeah, absolutely.
In Italy, and I suspect that in Sweden, it's the same. Bankruptcy is considered prima facie fraudulent, so you're doing something wrong, and it's up to you to prove you didn't do anything wrong. Yeah. Well, in this country, it's up to the country. Bankruptcy means nothing. It's like going to prison for three turns in Monopoly, and then you come out. And yeah. It's not as nothing as in the States, but almost. In the States, we actually have an expression that says, among entrepreneurs, that if by the age of 30 you haven't been bankrupt at least once, means that you haven't tried hard enough. And many of famous multimillionaire entrepreneurs have been bankrupt at least once. And so there are pros and cons on both philosophy. But so concentrating on what is in England, bankruptcy is not a serious matter. But you have to understand why the guy went bankrupt. So in any event, he made the company go bankrupt. And so if you were a landlord with 15 properties with him, for example, and the average deposit was £1,000, you lost overnight £15,000 because you still own the deposit to the tenant. The fact that the tenant gave it to the managing agent and the managing agent disappeared with the money is totally irrelevant. The agent was your agent, so collected on your behalf. Legally, you can even sue the managing agent because he's the company, so he's hiding behind the veil of the company. Hmm. If he was, although I still naughty because it's not that the money disappeared, he has pocketed the money from my point of view, right? Mm. And the deposit money shouldn't have been touched, even when it was you didn't have to protect it. Why did you touch the deposit money? It's not your money. But in so if he had any moral fiber, he should have said to his clients, sorry, my company went bankrupt, but I will personally refund your money. Maybe I will need a year or two, but I will give you the money. Not like, it's not me, it's my company. As if the company, as an entity, consumed the money by itself. The computer decided to use the money to buy microchips. Now, the money went from the company to your pocket somehow. But there's something else. So he never did that. So will you lend money? Will you joint venture with a person like that? Obviously not, if you have any brain. So why did you do it? Because you didn't know that. And why don't you didn't know that? Because you didn't do the due diligence. See, and it didn't even have to be that, because there were other things. Towards the last 6 months before he went bankrupt, or before people started to sue him and things like that, he became so desperate for money that he started to promise people online 4% return per month.
Oh, wow.
4% is 48 per annum, virtually 50%.
Yeah, that's
insane. No business can promise 50%. There is nothing that makes so much money. Not even, I don't know, having an oil well in Saudi.
No, not that you can promise either, because I mean, anything goes wrong and you're screwed.
And you see, and then he started to say, oh, this is backed by an insurance policy. I remember once he called me and said, Shimon, do you have anyone that could lend me money? And I says, what for? I said, no, don't worry. I can promise 4%. We give you also a healthy commission. I said, I don't say commission, but how can you promise 4%? It sounds too good to be true. But I'm a very blunt person, eh? And anyway, Toshima, don't worry. There is an insurance policy to protect people, so don't worry. And I says, oh, insurance policy, very good. Who's the insurance policy with? Aviva? NatWest? Lloyds? No, I mentioned the main. And he went, oh, it's a company based in Dubai. And we're like, what? Dubai? You're in England. Why do you need a company in Dubai? Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't want to offend. He says, sorry, no name comes to mind, but you know, obviously is a red flag. Well, what would you need an insurance policy in Dubai? Besides that, no proper insurance company in England will guarantee 50% of the return on anything, because nothing generates that profit. And of course he went back and bankrupt. And of course people lost money. But who were the people who lost money? Doesn't they be naive or too greedy? No, you're willing to give £50,000, £100,000, £200,000 to someone that you didn't know from Adam just because he promised a great return. And A, you didn't do any due diligence on the guy. B, you were not willing to spend £1,000 for a solicitor to draft a joint venture on a loan agreement. I not say for my sake, because as a law firm, we only buy and sell properties. So I don't draft joint venture agreements. But your joint venture with someone, you're willing to give £500,000 and then you go stingy for £1,000 or £2,000 of solicitor fees. You're an idiot, and in the nicest possible way. So due diligence is the next stage. And it's as simple as that. You have to check him out. And if you don't know how to check him out, ask someone that you trust or someone that pays someone to teach you how to check people out.
One of the things that comes up in the Facebook group, in the International Property Investors Facebook group, you know, that's just ask that question there. Both me and Shimon are in the group, or All About Property, where Shimon hangs out. It's not hard to find out how to do due diligence.
No, and I go as far as I get very protective of my joint venture partners. I remember the first joint venture that I did with an international student of mine. And there was a misunderstanding. I thought that they told me I have a lot of money, which that was true. Huh? But I thought that we were going to kind of exclusive joint venturing. So any project I found, they will bring the money. And then I will only bring projects to them, and they will only give money to me yet in the UK. I eventually find out that they started to do joint ventures with other people in the UK. Besides that, maybe it was a misunderstanding, so I they explained it, that was not what they understood at the beginning. Okay, fine, misunderstanding. And when I asked them who they were trying to joint venture with, they mentioned one guy that I knew, but I didn't know anything about him. But one guy that, again, was an ex-student. You know, I taught for 12 years for all main property organizations in this country. So I know a lot of people. So I knew the guy. And although I never really worked with a guy as a joint venture that I done with him, he didn't give me the impression that he was a straight arrow and an honest guy. So I told him, please, don't joint venture with this guy. They didn't believe that I was saying it for their sake, or maybe, I don't know, but they still proceeded. Mm. 2 years down the line, they lost several hundred thousand pounds. Mm. At least they were honest to tell me, because I wouldn't have known, because nothing to do with me, to tell me, Shimon, we should have listened to you and not do much with the guy.
And that one, that's gone so far, I believe they're going into bankruptcy because of that deal as well. So due diligence really is key.
And if you cannot find any information on the guy, better to err on the side of safety. Don't joint venture. And a lot of people that joint venture with me, and I say in the most honest way, I'm not claiming to be the best property investor on earth. There are probably other people that do a lot to make a lot of money. But you know, a lot of people joint venture with me because they trust me more than they have. I remember the first I did the. Few years ago, I did a joint venture, not a property related, on a different business, where they needed a solicitor. And I need to do very little, and they offered me 33%, which was a lot. In fairness, more than what I kind of deserved. Mm. And so I was in this business meeting, and with one of my best friends and business partner, Chapikul Hanif Khan, and we used to teach together. He's an amazing guy. And he's joint venture partner on this project. So after they told me what they wanted from me, the business, the nature, and my role, and things like that, I said, okay, I have a few questions. My first question, and everything depends on the first question, is why are you coming to me? Mm. They were both based in Birmingham. The business was in Birmingham. They were both Pakistani. In Birmingham, I think they're all Pakistani in Birmingham nowadays, and and says you can find, because of the economy, we both know that you can find a solicitor, a Pakistani solicitor in Birmingham, will do the same thing for 5%, and you offer me 33%. I like money, but you know, and I know that you're a very clever guy, so why? And smiled and says, fair enough, that would have been my first question too. And says, Shimon, and it's not because you're a solicitor, and nor because, I mean, they need a solicitor, and not because you're an extremely clever guy. The only reason why we prefer you than anyone else is because I trust you. I like to know that if I go on holiday in Dubai, at the time I used to be every year in Dubai on holiday, and if I go on holiday in Dubai for 2 weeks, when I come back, the money stays there. Mm. And that one for me was the biggest possible company you can make to me. Yeah. When people tell me, you're very clever. And why is a compliment to me? It's nice to say, oh, you have very nice eyes. Have I done anything about that? It's not, that is what God decides. Decides that I have nice eyes or that that I'm very clever. It's not that I work very hard to increase my QI. No, I didn't. I was born that with QI. Or someone tell me, oh, what a beautiful car you have. That's not me. It's my card, it's what my money bought. It's not like, if someone tells me how good, very nice painting that I painted, it's me. If they tell me very nice paint that I bought, it's not me. So the same thing is, if someone tells me he wants to join venture with me because he thinks, but it's for nothing, something else. He thinks that I'm a very honest guy, that it's me, because that I decided to do.
Yeah.
And to be able to trust is, yeah, maybe you can find someone that gives you a better return, not that people that offer. No, remember we said, maybe there is someone that will offer you 4% return per month. But maybe that means you get nothing. No, neither the return nor the principal altogether. So the due diligence is key. If you have to trust the guy. You're giving the guy, and even if it's not so much money you're putting time, efforts, and even when the joint venture is like the first example we use, is John, the marketing guy, and Mark, the negotiator. you put a lot of efforts and things like that. If something goes pear shape after, even if we don't look at the money side, the stress, the aggravation, it's not worth it. It's not worth it.
No, 100%. I agree. 100%. We're coming up on the end of the show. I think we got to wrap up.
Let me cover one point that we didn't cover.
Yes,
the last point that you should analyze is when you joint venture is the mentality of the person you joint venture with. I call it the joint venture mentality. Some people have a joint venture mentality. Some people don't. It's not that a person without joint venture mentality is a bad guy. The person with a joint venture mentality works better and he will be much more successful on his own than joint venturing. Mm. And they're better leaders, for example, because but they don't work well with other people because they tend to question everything. Mm. And you know the expression, the grass of the neighbor is also greener? Yeah. And that is what you don't want in joint venture. Especially when you joint venture and you go 50-50, right? How do you establish if that is 50-50? Oh, I bring in, it's not like I put in £50,000, you put £50,000, you go 50-50. Especially if you bring a different set of skill and assets, you cannot establish who brings 50%. There is no such a thing as 50%.
Nah, what is something it? I put in bad 10 hours. You're right. Yeah,
I put 10 hours, you put 10 hours? No. Like, remember the example of John and Mark, no? One is the negotiator, one is the marketeer, one is the negotiator. If as a negotiator, I need to spend every week 20 hours to negotiate all the deals, all the leads into deals, am I expecting my joint venture partner to spend 20 hours? Will I resent it that he spent 10 hours? What if my joint venture partner, the marketing guy, the guy that knows everything on the internet, spends 5 minutes a week? I need to spend 20 hours and he spends 5 minutes a week. Will I resent it? Because if I resent it, I'm not joint venture material.
Yeah.
Now, if my joint venture partners to generate the, let's say that I want him to generate 100 leads a week. If he and he, to negotiate 100 deal leads, maybe I converted 10 of them or 5 of them, we spend me 20 hours a week. Do I care if for him, if he needs to spend 20 hours like me or 5 minutes to generate 100 leads? What do I prefer? It should be exactly the contrary. I prefer that my joint venture partner spends only 5 minutes to generate the 100 leads. Mm. Why would a joint venture prefer to joint venture with an idiot when I can joint venture with a genius? I want my joint venture partner to be a genius, not an idiot.
Yeah, 100%.
But can you see that the reverse is John going to Mark and says, Mark, you're a nice guy and great negotiator, but without my leads, you have nothing to negotiate. Surely I should have the lion's share of the business. Mm. Mark looking at John and says, I like your thinking, but you know, leads, maybe you can buy them at £100, £150 a pop. Negotiated deals, maybe I sell them for £3,000, £5,000 each. Surely I should have the lion's share of the business. Who's right there? They're both wrong. Both of them have the wrong mentality to be a joint venture partner. Mm. You joint venture with someone because it will help you to make you much more money. Whether it takes 5 minutes, 5 hours, £2, £200 million, totally irrelevant to me. I don't care what my joint venture partner has to do. Whatever is his contribution, if his contribution means that instead of making £100,000 a year, I make £500,000 a year, for goodness sake, even if I need to just use his photo. Mm. So he does do nothing whatsoever but giving me his photo. It's worth it for me. Yeah. Let's do the example. Your joint venture partner is Bill Gates. Bill Gates will say, okay, joint venture with you, you can use my name to tell people I'm your business partner.
Yeah.
Will you open your auto doors?
Of course.
Finance, banks, and things like that. Will you resent if Bill Gates doesn't spend 20 hours a week with you? No, you don't. No,
nope, doesn't spend a minute with me. I'm still happy in that relationship. I think that's a good idea. I'll call Bill right now and see if we can get into a partnership. I'm sure.
Too late.
Ah, already made the call. Too bad. Well, I'm your partner, so an extension.
Good enough for me. That is what I need.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Shimon. This was so valuable. Thank you, everyone who joined us. Now, Shimon, if they want to reach you and connect with you, how do they best reach you to learn more or work with you or hire a law firm?
Best way to communicate with me is my email. As always, my email. So I'm sure that you can provide them. In there, it is Shimon, S-H-I-M-O-N, at msms-law-whiskey.co.uk. If not, message me on Facebook through Messenger. Emails are better. Initial chat we can have to contact me, just send me a message if you didn't catch my email or if you don't get it from Daniel. There is only one Shimon Rudik, and my picture is my profile, and although it's an old picture, so it's all black, and there is no gray in my beard. And then Justin, you get in touch. That's all.
Great. So it's Shimon at mslaw.com.
MS-law.
Yep. Awesome. Thank you so much again, Shimon. Thank you so much, everyone, for watching or listening. We really appreciate you and have an amazing day.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that episode, and I hope you take this and implement it into your career. Thank you so much for joining us and listening all the way through. I hope you got a lot of value. And again, it doesn't mean anything unless you implement it, so make sure you implement it. Again, I want to thank you for being a part of this community, for joining us on these episodes, because it means so much to me that we're able to bring these people on and to share. And I really appreciated all the comments, all the emails, all the suggestions that you send in. It means so much to me. So thank you so much for that. And if you have the chance, I would love it if you could go in and whatever provider you're using, give us a review. If you gave us a 5-star review, it helps us reach more people with the podcast and continue to grow. So if you could do that, I'd really appreciate it. Thank you so much. I also want to let you know that we've created something new in Momentum. Momentum Property Education has started, as you might know, in our group, International Property Investors. We do every single week, we do a live Q&A. So you can join the group, International Property Investors, on Facebook, and every week we do a live Q&A. What's so exciting is at that Q&A, for those who are active, who are commenting, and who are liking, and who are participating in it, well, what we now have decided to do is create a competition. So you'll essentially be a part of a raffle where every week, one person who's been active will win a free coaching call where we'll map out your investing future, your next steps, and kind of answer your questions. So make sure you join International Property Investors and jump on these weekly Q&As. They are at 2 p.m. Central European time, you know, Swedish time, Amsterdam time, 2 p.m. Wednesday. So if you're with live, you comment, you like, you participate, you have a chance to win one of those coaching calls. So I hope you join us. Now, next week's episode is super, super exciting. We have one of the most famous names in UK property joining us, Simon Zucci himself. Simon has been investing for decades. He is the founder of PIN, Property Investor Network, which is now the largest investor community in the UK, doing, I think it's about 52 meetups every month all over the United Kingdom. Simon himself has coached dozens and, hundreds of investors on their property journey. He is an incredible investor himself, and he's joined us for this episode. So you're going to love it. He shares a lot of very powerful lessons from his new book that is coming out soon, as well as lease options. We talk about a lot about lease options and how you can implement it as an international investor. So it was a super exciting and an honor to have Simon come on the episode. And I hope you make sure to be there next week when it comes out Tuesday to listen, because you're going to get an incredible, incredible amount of value. So I'll see you